Game design. Wow, well, it appears you caught me at a weird time. I'm floating just outside this Gecko class transport, watching its class 2 reactor go critical because I clipped a coolant line and couldn't free the reactor from its containment cage to safely salvage it. Happens every day, right? I'm too far away to be unglued at the subatomic level, but this is going to make salvaging this ship significantly more difficult and make paying down my billion-dollar work debt that much harder. But for any of this to make sense, we have to go back. Way back. Back into time. We did it, guys. We broke the damn Earth. It's a mess that was 100% preventable. We had a plan to keep it from getting worse, but we didn't even try, and now everyone wants to get off. Including us. The cost for getting off-world, however, is hardcore dystopia. By becoming a servant of the Lynx Corporation, your job is now to pay down your billion-dollar rocket ride by salvaging spaceships. Lynx owns you and your DNA. If you die in an accident, they reclone you, staple the feed to your debt pile, and move on. Your helmet sound system plays twangy country tunes calibrated precisely to make you more productive. Lynx is more concerned about the equipment you're borrowing than it is about you. The setup is pretty grim, but as you work 15-minute shift after 15-minute shift breaking down ships towed in from the cosmos, that all thankfully becomes cynically humorous. Similar to your role as a faceless resource gatherer for Fix-It in Satisfactory, or the lab rat Chell in the Portal games. Heartspace Shipbreaker is a very utilitarian title for a working-class space game. Either name would be perfect on its own. Heartspace is good. Shipbreaker is good. Together, it's a tough sell. It's hard enough to describe the game as is to someone, but a long title like that makes it harder. As it turns out, the title has an even longer history. Developer Blackbird Interactive is a Vancouver-based studio made up of people who formed Relic in the late 90s. The guys responsible for the incredibly innovative Homeworld games, and you see the visual language flow through these two games with its angular ships and use of bright colors. Those were very stylish real-time strategies that took place in 3D space, whereas the competition was still fighting over large, flat terra firma. Blackbird's first game was a more conventional RTS, and since they couldn't acquire the Homeworld rights from THQ, they had to make their own universe, so their game became Hardware Shipbreakers. When THQ went bankrupt in 2012, Gearbox, yes, that Gearbox, outbid Blackbird to acquire the Homeworld rights, but gave them a license to use it anyway, and then commissioned them to work on Homeworld 3, which will be out next year. Hardware Shipbreakers became Homeworld Shipbreakers became prequel Homeworld Deserts of Carrick, named after the deserting planet you depart in the original game. So this new game. As an internal game jam demo at Blackbird, it carried the slightly more svelte but still kinda confusing name, Hello Collector, but we can see they ultimately adopted the title they tossed out for their debut game in Hardspace Shipbreaker. Phew. In Shipbreaker, your job is to pick a ship and, well, break it down for as much value as possible. Even as a servant to this massive space corporation, you still get some leeway about how you do your job, in much the same way that gig workers have some freedom driving for Lyft and Uber for pennies on the dollar. Picking through the catalog of derelict craft from a variety of future consortiums, Lynx wisely advises you that the actual salvaged amount is only estimated, because even with the most incredible patience, you'll never 100% salvage what the vessel is worth. And frankly, you won't want to. I'll explain why in a bit. I'm playing this game in the standard difficulty, but you can create an open shift profile that doesn't have the time or oxygen restrictions of the higher difficulties, which also gradually reduce the number of times you can be recloned to zero. In your berth, you can move at your own pace, but each 15-minute shift comes with a price tag and a slew of fees. Since you don't own any of your equipment, at least not initially, you'll have to pay for those as well. Take as long as you want, be as meticulous as you want, but you're just eating your own profit after a point. Your berth consists of a few major components that you'll get used to real quick. In the middle is your operating space and your target ship. On either side are a collector and furnace, both sides, for convenience, to deposit raw materials. Below is the barge, where you can send integrated components like engines, reactors, antenna, and so forth. It's a giant sticky pad you just fling stuff at. Above are stationary jacks that you can tether parts of your ship in progress to simply move them out of the way, or prevent them from falling into collection spaces before you've fully picked them through. Finally, there's the Master Jack, your new home, and the storefront from which you resupply oxygen and fuel, load up on repair kits, and so on. Never run out of fuel, by the way. It's a bad story. Oh, and if someone made a Master Jack model or Lego mock, I would love one for my desk. Now it's just you and your tools and the ship. And 15 minutes. The game is the full 6 degrees of freedom that Descent trained you for. I play with a controller and I have no idea why you'd use a keyboard and mouse. It's just perfect with a controller. A joystick? Maybe, sure. The physics are Newtonian and you quickly build up a lot of inertia. This means you have to manage your velocity, manage the mass of the ship and its parts, brake appropriately, and so on. Up can quickly become down, sideways can be upright, or not, and you can get lost in your own berth easily as the salvage twists in space. It takes a little getting used to, but soon you'll be bouncing parts left and right while you perform slick moves flinging yourself around hulls. The universe is also mute, because there is no sound in space. All of the ships you encounter are still pressurized, meaning they have an oxygen atmosphere and are accessible by airlock. This means you can regain oxygen from the murky environments you float through, and at better rates as you work up the equipment trees. We'll get back to that. I found that even if I had to fly back to the Master Jack for oxygen halfway through each shift, depressurizing the whole ship was a major first priority after stripping down the external bits. Explosive decompression is a real nightmare in this game, and it comes quickly with just one misplaced laser blast. In smaller spaces, it's inconvenient. In larger ones, it's fatal. There are 6 different sizes of randomly generated ships which you unlock as you complete certifications, which you do by salvaging specific components and completing work order objectives. There are 3 different kinds of ships, mackerels on the low end, and geckos and now javelins on the high end. They'll be configured differently in each case, but you develop a routine pretty quick about how to most easily strip each ship down. Oh, and each randomly generated ship will come with a randomly generated work order. While a lowly mackerel takes me 2 to 3 shifts to strip down, a larger ship can take hours. So work orders give you some direction on what components Lynx is actually looking for from this salvage. It's extremely easy to get into the weeds and break ships down for far longer than you have the time or patience for. Sending dozens of javelin containers to the barge after severing them from the hull is so, so monotonous. Salvaging each an individual light or poster, likewise, is really just a waste of time. And while it's not a bug, there is a not feature in which you lose the ship you're working on if you quit the game. Blackbird simply hasn't built the functionality to save your berth space mid-operation. This means if you want to thoroughly and completely dismantle a larger ship, you'll have to do it all in one play session, shift after shift. On top of being pressurized, each ship is some grid paper variant of the same double hull design. The outer hull is made up of a semi-impenetrable nanocarbon that protects the ship from the hostility of space. On the inside is a more conventional titanium and aluminum hull that can be sliced up Fruit Ninja style that holds all the amenities of space travel, like chairs, computers, beds, and bags of popcorn. These hulls are tied to themselves and each other by cut points, which are usually the second thing I tackle after depressurizing the vessel. Since nanocarbon can't be directly damaged by your cutter, you'll have to sneak in between the hulls and break it apart from the inside. As you do this, parts of the ship will float away. Nanocarbon goes in the collector tunnel, while lesser and broken materials will go in the furnace. If you're ever lost, you can bring up your scanner, which will highlight where the different materials and components go. Well, as you upgrade it anyway. If you send the wrong materials to the wrong collector, you get yelled at, and then you obviously lose that salvage. I wish the game provided monetary values in the field for what you're salvaging instead of weight as they're collected, rather than waiting for the end screen. Despite having a meter indicating how much of the vessel's mass remains, the game doesn't notify you to stop salvaging once the vast majority of the ship has been collected. So you can sit there spinning in space all day long, tracking down crumb-sized fragments if you wanted to. I'll give you a hint, it's extremely unprofitable. Your tools are simple enough, and this newest big update changed how you switch between them, so I still struggle with that from time to time. Your 2 primary tools are your cutter and your grappler. Your cutter is your slicer and dicer. Its first mode is a freaking laser that can be precisely aimed to melt specific targets, but it takes a bit longer than I'd like. The second mode is a Dead Space-like slicer that allows you to smash cut points with ease or do some freehand slicing if you just need to remove some unhelpful panels. Doing this can make a mess super quick, though. Your grappler is your gravity gun, allowing you to grab individual items in the ship, yank them off whatever surface they're stuck to, reel objects towards you, or if they're too massive, you to them. The grappler also allows you to deploy the incredibly important self-retracting tethers that allow you to send materials and components into each collection pod on their own, rather than trying to play gravity games with your flinging and pushing. Items with more mass, like the entire inner hull of a Gecko, will require more tethers to pull, if you can pull them at all. You may have to break things down even further, which brings me to the newly added demo charges. They allow you to slice up nanocarbon trusses and joints, or anything else for that matter, that makes salvage easier. It's also a damn satisfying tool when used just right. All of your equipment can be upgraded using Lynx tokens, or LT, which you gain by completing work order objectives. Moving through these various trees will make life so much easier, like when tethers don't expire after a minute, or you can have more of them, or malfunctioning electrical devices don't cause as much damage, or demo charges don't blow up half the ship, etc. Figuring each of these ships out is like solving a sequential puzzle, and as you work through them, it becomes incredibly rewarding to develop routines that let you gain the most money with the leanest effort, even with the variations in ships. It's easy enough to learn where to send raw materials and fling small stuff like computer terminals and soft storage packs, but if you really want to make money and knock out your work orders, you need to figure out how to safely remove the still vital drive system. Yes, all of these ships arrive with still lively reactors and engines, a potentially dangerous proposition. On the smaller mackerels, it's easy enough. You can remove the engine and the reactor separately. On the larger ships, they're tied together by rigid lines for fuel and coolant. Using utility keys, you can flush fuel, but once you sever or remove coolant from the Mark II reactor, well, you already know what's gonna happen if you can't get it to the barge before it melts down entirely. Your scanner will eventually allow you to see these systems independently, so you can assess the situation and make disassembly plans. The Javelin-class ships, however, will let you pretty much send the entire drive system to the barge in one piece, provided you've removed the outer nanocarbon bell from the rear of the ship. There will be times when you will feel very lonely. Scattered throughout these ships are encrypted hard drives that include world-filling emails, advertisements, and audio logs. These are things happening far away from you. One email warns you that you get 5 solid years as a Lynx salvager, a one-er in the parlance, before the hostile space environment degrades your body to the point where work becomes extremely difficult. Then you become a zero. This isn't something that reflects in the game mechanically, it's just haunting to think about, like the billion-dollar debt that never really seems to get any smaller. You'll also have the opportunity to work on quote-unquote ghost ships that are taken over by AI and feature nodes barnacled onto major electronic systems that scream when you blast them away. In this future, artificial intelligence is outlawed and these ships introduce some light shades of horror to the mix, especially as the AI's signals interfere with your scanner. But there really doesn't seem to be much of a story or structure behind these ships or what the AI movement really is or what happened to these vessels, so on and so forth. Maybe that's coming in time. Also, no matter how hard I tried, I never seemed to destroy enough AI nodes on any ship to fulfill the work order requirement that comes with those vessels. Again, probably coming in time. I do want to note that the Foley work in this game is incredible. No, there technically isn't any sound in space, but it is reflected through the atmosphere of your suit, and you can gain abilities to synthesize sound in pressurized environments. My favorite is the gradually more desperate gasping and alarming as you run out of oxygen, usually on your way to the Master Jack to purchase another oxygen tank because you couldn't find the one you swear you saw in one of the ship's side rooms. Ripping ships apart layer by layer is fun as hell, but Blackbird hasn't quite nailed down progression yet. In fact, there are several aspects of the game that still feel like they're largely tweaking sliders, like the effect of wear and tear on your equipment. Your real progress is through gaining enough LT to upgrade your abilities and by unlocking stickers, which are essentially internal achievements you can slap on your grappler or cutter. The game also, and it's strange I'm saying this, offers you too much choice about what ships to pick through. Unlocking larger ships provides bigger payouts, but they also take a while to salvage and will tire you out if you do them one after the other. Smaller ships are a nice diversion, but their payouts are naturally significantly smaller. If the game funneled you into a smaller selection of vessels, or only specific kinds became available at any point, you'd have greater odds of having a more diverse experience than getting comfortable and then burn out on the game with the same few ships. The most confusing screen in the entire game is the fees sheet when you get back into the hab after a shift. It tells you what the shift's fees were, how much the shift's salvage was worth, again, and then your remaining debt. At this point, you could pull out a calculator and figure out how much you actually chipped away to your massive balance, or how much you've profited off a particular ship so far, because the game doesn't give you either amount, but I mean, does it matter? There's nothing to be gained by whittling down your debt at this point except to make the number smaller. Nothing unlocks, nothing gets better, the number just gets smaller. And the thing is, you can buy supplies as much as you want and just add to your debt as well, and it doesn't really matter. Short of something that I'm sure they'll add in the future that's on some unseen development roadmap, this is really just the toll of any working class job, right? You make enough to survive and you find something about the job you enjoy enough to not want to quit the next time you walk in. What really happens if we become a zero before we pay off our debt? Will we have the bone strength to push mops and tow buckets in far more mundane work? Are we sent back to the home planet we ravaged without a second chance? While it's a solid 15 minutes of fun over and over again, still in search of a sturdier frame story, make no mistake, I love Hard Space Shipbreaker. I've wanted to make a video about this game for months, back when I was unemployed and still committed to weekly videos. Having put 40 hours into it total following the huge pre-Christmas businesses booming update, I felt now was probably the best time to do it before I dive into another lengthy nth review. Shipbreaker is still in early access, otherwise it would probably qualify for a full review. But I really didn't want to wait. I had to show someone this game. You, actually. I'm excited about where this game is going, and I hope you get to play it as well. I'm not usually a fan of early access titles because I fear of tuckering out on them before they present their full offering, but this is a game I've dreamt of, a true dad's game among dad games, and I can't wait to see what's next.
Hey reviewers, good to see ya. It's really nice to be able to do a shorter video this time around that isn't 5 hours, but that will not stop me from doing videos like that in the future. I do appreciate you watching this video on Hard Space Shipbreaker. I am really excited about this game. I hope I don't stop playing it because I just did this video. Anyway, come find me on Discord and Facebook and Twitter and Reddit and wherever places. I do want to thank my Patreon supporters, my producers right here. And if you'd like to see more videos like this, quicker, much quicker, please consider contributing to my Patreon. Don't forget to like and subscribe over here. And hey, I'll see you next time.